A new Doctor Who serial, The Green Death, begins next Saturday at the same time.
It was hard being a Doctor Who fan in the 1970s. There was no video, no DVD, no endless repeats on cable. But I had my own way of recreating the atmosphere of the programme during the parts of the week that had the audacity not to be Saturday tea time.
The Doctor Who theme is now available on a BBC record from most record shops.
That single had a name on the circular label at the centre, an alliterative name that sounded like the heroine of an Enid Blyton story, Delia Derbyshire, the woman who, in 1963, used feedback and bits of tape to create the authentic sound of travelling through space and time. But there was much more to Delia than that one arrangement. She was a pioneer, a genius, a powerhouse of musical creativity. And I'm here at Manchester University to investigate the woman behind the Wobulator. Delia was born in Coventry 3 years before the Luftwaffe attempted to wipe it off the map. She thought she was clever, and Girton College, Cambridge agreed. She left with a degree in music and maths and an ambition to work in the recording business, which took a blow in 1959 when Decca told her that the studio was no place for a woman. The UN had no such scruples. Delia worked for them in Geneva before returning to London to take a job with a music publisher. But our story starts in 1960, when Delia joined the BBC as a trainee studio manager. And it was then that she started asking questions about a mysterious department called the Radiophonic Workshop, where boffins did avant-garde things with tape spools. Here's former workshop composer Peter Howell.
Daphne Oram and Desmond Briscoe were the founders of the workshop. And they were studio managers in drama department in radio. And they were given two old tape recorders to play with. And they spent their time doing special sound sequences for dramas. But it sort of took off because it was in the era when radio drama was really at its height. And they did a lot of sound sequences for those sort of things, and they were the weird and the wonderful.
Here's Desmond Briscoe.
We are essentially specialists in sound. The fact that if you take sound and organise it in certain ways and along certain lines, and bearing in mind certain parameters, what you produce, of course, is something which we tend to know generally as music.
And so Delia applied to join these specialists in sound. From 1960 to the mid-70s, Delia was part of the musical counterculture. She made bizarre pop tracks with Anthony Newley, composed hymns for robots and soundtracks for horror pictures. She created a soundscape for the world's first electronic music fashion show.
Well, any sound can be made into a radiophonic sound by the treatment it receives. The sort of sounds we usually use are electronic sounds of various sorts, and also sounds that are recorded, picked up by a microphone, everyday sounds, and also musical instruments. All these are sources of sound.
Have you ever thought what it's like to be wanderers in the fourth dimension?
Those basic sounds aren't really interesting in their raw state like this. We have to shape them and mould them.
Vacuous and simultaneously arrogant, rowdy, musical, illiterate, scruffy John Peel. I find thee apt, and duller shouldst thou be than the fat weed that roots itself in ease on Lethe Wharf, wouldst thou not stir in this?
The point is not whether you understand, what is going to happen to you?
By the mid-1970s, though, Delia was disillusioned with the direction that electronic music seemed to be taking. She always maintained that this was down to the arrival of something called the synthesizer. She wanted electronic music to be handmade. So she left the workshop, gave up composing, and withdrew from the profession. She worked in an art gallery, a bookshop, and for the gas board. She drank a lot of red wine, but she never asked for anybody's sympathy.
Me on the outside was one left to right. Within ourselves the sun saw the night. Just bound by blue ethereality. Drifting out to my dream free.
The world lost Delia Derbyshire in 2001, but her legacy is still very much alive, not just in the Doctor Who theme, but in a whole back catalogue of lesser-known work that she left behind. A catalogue that was recently augmented by Delia's personal collection of recordings, which was presented to Manchester University by composer and radiophonic workshop archivist Mark Ayres. But how did Mark acquire the collection in the first place?
When Delia died, her partner Clive discovered all these boxes in her attic. Just a number of sort of tea chests and cardboard boxes all falling to bits, all full of tapes, which one day had sticky labels on them, but all the sticky labels had fallen off and were at the bottom of the boxes, so we were just left with hundreds of reels of tapes and the labels. So it was a real jigsaw puzzle. Initially, Brian Hodgson took delivery of the tapes. Brian, of course, lifelong friend of Delia's and colleague at the BBC Radiophonic Workshop. And he weeded out a lot of stuff because basically Delia seemed to have, when she left the BBC, just emptied her studio into the back of a car. So a lot of them were either blank tapes or just echo tapes and just bits of edits which weren't going anywhere, or duplicates of things we already had. So Brian did an initial sort of weed through, but I still ended up with about 300 reels of tapes. Then David Butler from Manchester University contacted me initially with an interest to work on the Radiophonic Workshop catalogue in an academic capacity. But I seized the opportunity to suggest that there was a much more interesting project that he might like to take on.
The strange thing about it was that all the tapes were in boxes of breakfast cereal, of bran flakes. And in a way, that seemed to kind of encapsulate Delia's music and the way it sort of has reached out to audiences, particularly in Britain. And that is that, you know, you've got something which is innovative and experimental and very progressive in many ways, but also is going into people's front rooms, you know, on a weekly basis. So there was something like that combination of the extraordinary and the ordinary, you know, the mundane, and which kind of seemed right in a way, but also very odd.